don't know if you've heard this, but I've heard from people speaking about how they become Christians and what persuades them and how they get there. And the sort of response you sometimes get from people is that it just seemed right. It just felt right. I was looking into it, I was exploring, I was asking questions, but it just felt, and somebody said to me once, it felt like coming home. It felt like coming home. Last time we looked at freedom, and this time we're looking at family, as it were. We're looking at adoption, because adoption is a word picture that Scripture picks up, Paul in particular picks up, and he uses to describe the new experience of God that people come into when they become a Christian. It's to do with your experience of God. And Wayne Grudem, who's written a big book on what the Bible's about, he says, adoption is an act of God whereby he makes us members of his family. And there's such a brief, to the point, concise explanation. But wow, what a wonder that is. God makes people like us members of his family. We're not necessarily that desirable. We're not necessarily that gifted. Some of us are not that good looking. And he takes people who are outsiders, makes them his family. Now, please notice this. It's not the people starting from scratch. It's the people who have had bad experience of exploitative and possibly abusive parenting, in inverted commas, that have been brought into this position. So in Galatians, Paul is writing this. As long as an heir is underage, he is no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. The heir is subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by his father. So also, when we were underage, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world, he says in Galatians 4. And then he says, but God stepped in to redeem us, not just to redeem us, but to adopt us into the family of God. So to open up the subject then, let's ask first of all, who needs adoption? And I guess the answer, pretty standard answer, would be children haven't got parents. But the point is this, all children have got parents. There are parents for them. It's not people who never had parents, but it's people who possibly can't remember their parents, possibly never met their parents, but they certainly had, and they maybe have biological parents, but something somewhere has gone wrong. And what they've had was poor parenting, maybe a parent that couldn't cope. Maybe a parent who through an illness or an addiction or some sort of mental incapacity or something wasn't able to be parent to them in the fullest sense. Perhaps in certain parts of the world, perhaps a parent couldn't afford their child and gave them up for adoption. Or somebody else who could afford it. Perhaps a parent was unable to discipline themselves, let alone their child. Things went wrong from there on. The crucial point here is this, that in the first century Roman world, it wasn't like that. Now, of course, Scripture speaks about the sort of parenting, in inverted commas, that we had before we became Christians, from the world we live in, from the enemy of souls. But in the Roman world, the first century AD, there was more to it than that. It wasn't about making the best of a bad job. Now, adoption is a great thing. It's a fantastic thing. It's a big, huge thing for somebody to do or have done for them. It's a great thing. But in the Roman world of the first century AD, they had a different sort of take on adoption altogether. The idea of adoption into a family is much more a Roman than a Jewish idea. In the Jewish world, kids were kind of looked after, and there was levirate marriage and all that. But in Roman society, it was a big thing. Now, interestingly, when you look for the word adoption in the New Testament, you find it in Paul's writings. You find it in the writings of Paul as the apostle of the Gentiles, because it's a big deal for the Gentiles. When you come to something like John and John's Gospel and 1 John, the truth behind it is explained, but that word isn't used, it isn't a concept appealed to, because of the different worlds they're working in. So John 14:18, Jesus says, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. And it's all in the context of the Spirit being sent after his departure from this world. But it is the Romans, who the pagan society that Paul's dealing with, they have this big thing associated with adoption. And adoption in the Roman world gave full civil status. The full civil status of the family you're adopted into. So very often a person of low social standing, even a slave, would be bought by a Roman patrician family because they were bright, talented, whatever. And brought in, not simply to secure the family line, but maybe to do something good for the dynasty. Emperors were even made in this way. So the Emperor Augustus, who was the first emperor of the Roman Empire, possibly the most famous example of adoption in ancient Rome. Born into a relatively obscure family under the name Gaius Octavius, he's adopted into the Julii Caesaris family by his maternal great-uncle, Julius Caesar. And having been brought in, his name was changed and all the rest of it, but he ended up becoming the Emperor Augustus. So you can see there was a lot more to it. There was advantage, there was benefit, but there was this full civil status being accorded. So Paul then mainly seems to pick up on the idea, and he takes that into his writing of scripture. He identifies something that existed in contemporary secular society as a, for instance, to describe the relationship to God that the believer enters into when they're converted. How does it look in scripture? So we've said John picks up the idea that's behind it without using the term and appealing to the Roman baggage. John's gospel has an awful lot in it to tell us that it's about the Jewish world and Jewish people. Not necessarily exclusively, but that's a big theme in its cultural background. So in John 1:12, John has written about the Word of God coming into the world, that Jesus coming as the eternal Word, talked about the eternal nature and character of the Lord Jesus. And then he says, the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He's talking about Jesus. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him yet. To all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. See, status. The full status is conveyed of being children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. Now, what does he have to say to Nicodemus when Nicodemus turns up? Nicodemus, the Jewish leader, turns up, right? Prestigious guy in the Jewish religion, turns up and Jesus says to him, Nicodemus, you must be born again. It's this whole idea of being born into a fresh family that adoption conveys in the Roman world, but this idea of being born again into a new family conveys in the Jewish world. Does that put an interesting perspective on it? So we've said it is John who sort of does that and uses the idea, the concept that way. But Paul talks about adoption. So it's obviously true that you can't become a Christian unless you're born again. But the flip side of that, in terms of Paul's theology, the New Testament letters, is that adoption is what takes place when you become a believer. You're born again into the family of God. And those are the two sort of sides to the underlying truth. So in Galatians 4, there's a classic example of adoption. Two main passages about adoption, Galatians 4 and Romans 8. and sort of flanking it on both ends in terms of the way the Bible books are arranged is John, with the stuff we've just been looking at. So those who received him and believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, sons of God, born not of natural descent, but born of God. And then in Galatians 4:4-7, and in Romans 8, Paul uses the metaphor of adoption. And then in 1 John 3, John picks it up again at the end. So Galatians 4, what I'm saying, writes Paul, is that as long as an heir is underage, he's no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. He's got to behave himself. There are rules, there are regulations. He complies. The heir is subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by his father. So also, when we were underage, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. He's talking about the law and the old covenant. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law. Why? That we might receive the adoption of sonship. The point of Jesus coming, the point of Jesus Christ paying the price of sin, dying on the cross, rising again from the dead, and we're around Easter at the moment. The point of that is that those who are under the law, rules, regulations, obey but you can't. So you're a lawbreaker. So sin is the problem you've got. God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, keeping it, so that he could redeem those who were living under the law, this terribly harsh guardian. He did that to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. And that's a whole different ballgame, because, Galatians 4:6, because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. The Spirit who calls out, Abba Father, and is anxious for God, is keen for that relationship which reorientates conduct. So you've been under the law. You've been in this rules and regulations and punishment situation. And what happens is that this coming of age and adoption means that the Spirit of God has been sent into your heart, and that reorientates your desires, your passions, what you long for and cry out for. Abba Father, no longer a slave, but God's child, bearing the likeness, because the Spirit has been sent into your heart. And since you are his child, Galatians 4:7, God has made you also an heir. The whole picture of this Roman adoption thing was that you came into the family and got the goods. You gained the civil status of a son. Does that make sense? So in your experience of God, what's happened is that you've been moved away from the legal obligation in fear of punishment to regulate your conduct. In your experience, the indwelling Holy Spirit reorientating your heart. Hungry for God now, not resistant, resentful, but keen. Because of the privilege that's been given you, and because the Spirit has been sent in, crying out, Abba Father. So you habitually cry out to God. It's God you cry out. No longer a slave, his child. And because a child, his heir, grateful, reorientated into a different way of life out of gratitude for what's been done for you. I want to suggest to you a status is conferred. And that status having been conferred is important. There are very many very fearful Christians about. We live in a world where there's a great deal of hostility to God and to the things of God and to what God would say and what God's about and what he stands for. And it's easy in that sort of context to go onto the back foot. The thing about being the son of a king is that you can stand in the presence of kings, even of kings. Rulers and governors are not a problem to you, because you're the son of the king. And the way that you handle yourself and the way you conduct yourself will be consistent with this thing that you are the son of the king. you will not be fearful. Because you've been redeemed from under the law so that you could be adopted to being the Son of God. And because that's happened to you, God has sent His Spirit into your heart, and that Spirit cries out, Abba Father, as if He is your sufficiency, your help is all you need. No reason to be ashamed. No longer a slave, His child, able to hold your head up, and your status is conferred. And that carries through into the future, because having been made His child, He's made you His heir. Caleb and I were somewhere last week, and somebody was talking about a soldier who wanted to go and see Abraham Lincoln, who was then the president. Now, I haven't checked this story, but it's a good story. That's all I can tell you. And he wanted to get in, and he met a child walking in the park. And the child walking in the park said, I can get you in to see the president. And so the soldier goes with the child, and they walk up to the White House, and they walk in through the gates, and they walk along the corridor, and they walk to an office at the end of the corridor. And the child doesn't even knock. He opens the door and comes in, and an aide springs forward to stop this happening. And the president looks up from his desk and he says, don't stop the boy. He comes on in because he is the son of the president. And the story was told from the perspective that if you are with the son of the president, you can come into the presence of the president. But look, the son has free access to the father because of the status that is his, because he's the son of the president. And it holds also for the king. It conveys a status. So Paul writes about this in Galatians 4, but he also writes about it in a slightly different context in Romans 8. We're related to God with the implication we're related to one another in the family of God, of course. But Paul explains how this doctrine of adoption brings together people from all manner of backgrounds and temperaments. You change family. You change orientation, you change status, and it brings about big changes in the behaviour required of the adoptee. I was looking at this and I saw some stuff by Krish Kandaya, who used to be the big noise in the Evangelical Alliance, and he's involved in an organisation, a Christian organisation called Home for Good, which is there to encourage and help and support Christian people to adopt children. And they've been very involved with adopting refugee children in recent days. And he's got a little video there. It's all about adopting refugee children. It's explaining how to be, how to put that child at ease. Because this child has come from where? Syria, Afghanistan, where? From a very different situation, culture. There are, I think, 15,000 unaccompanied children waiting at borders in Europe. It's the latest figures we've got. And they're on their own there. For one reason or another, there's no parent with them. There's nobody to look after them. And so they're concerned to, you know, bring children into adoptive situations. But imagine being a child that's come from somewhere or other, through maybe Turkey, and your parent has been lost. And you're on your own. And then all of a sudden, you know, you're into a new country, a new culture, new language, new food, new everything, and you're adopted into a family. There are going to be big changes for the adoptee. You will be using a toilet differently. To put no finer point on it than that. You'll be eating food, and you'll be eating it differently. Tone of voice is really important to build trust and confidence. You know, changes are being made. And Paul is writing to these Romans, and he's saying, look, don't even begin to think that now you're a Christian, you're forgiven, you can behave how you like, because Jesus paid the price, you can get on with sin. He says, if you live, Romans 8:13, according to the flesh, you'll die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Now, he's not re-erecting the law. Because how he explains it is this. Those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. There's this identification. If you're the child of God, you're led by the Spirit of God. If you're led by the Spirit of God, then you're the child of God. The two things go together. And the Spirit you receive does not make you slaves, so you live in fear again, as if the law was the big old taskmaster and somebody standing over you with a stick to beat you when you mess up. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. You're growing into the family likeness, you adopted person. And by that Spirit that you received, who brought about your adoption to sonship, by him we cry, Abba, Father. We are hungry for God. We long for God. Grateful because we're adopted, but reorientated from the inside out to the Spirit that comes and lives in you when you're adopted into the family of God. When you're born again, John might say. And the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Here's how you're assured of the whole deal. Here's how you're assured that you have become a Christian, that it is true, you are adopted into the family of God, you have been born again, you are saved. Because in you is this crying out for God and wanting him. The Spirit himself then, inside us, doing this stuff, testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. This is where your assurance comes from, that it's worth it that you are a believer. Now, if we're children, then we're heirs. Heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. There are two sides to the inheritance, actually. There's nasty stuff that happens in this world, but also, hey, there's glory. Changing family involves big changes for the adoptee. And there are new standards of behaviour, new ways of doing things and so on. And under the old relationship, it was all rules and regulations and big stick. The imposition of those rules using the mechanisms of fear. But Paul here indicates a new way of making those changes that are necessary in the young life. Being adopted into the new family of God, Spirit active in our hearts, gratitude, joy, reassurance, hope of glory. There is new parental leadership exercised by the indwelling Spirit. And the changes that need to be made in the new adoptee are made by living under his leadership in gratitude for what's been done. There was talk of God as being Father in the Old Testament. Psalm 103:13, Isaiah 43:6-7, Malachi 1:6 and 2:10, Grudem cites those passages. But the experience of God as Father in this sense is pretty much something that belongs to the experience of the gospel. And that experience is based on the objective gospel truth that Paul has been talking about in the first 7-8 chapters of Romans. So what evidence do we see in our lives that we are God's children? God's children are led by the Spirit of God into his ways. And they're grateful. And they see him as family and they cry out, Abba, Father, to him. They cry out to God. And the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. If children is, and that is the hope which effects change in us. The hope that effects change in us. As John points out, not using the word adopted, but describing the nature of adoption in John 1:3-2. Look at this. This is great, isn't it? How encouraging, how nice is this? See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. Children of God. What an honour. That's what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that they did not know him. Dear friends, now we're children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. We shall see him as he is. Now what's the effect of that on a person? Knowing that comforting, great love the Father's lavished on us, making us children of God. What's the effect of that on us? 1 John 3:3, all who have this hope in them purify themselves just as he is pure. The effect of adoption is to change your situation, your status, your circumstances, your confidence, and your life. You've got that hope in you. That's what you're heading for. That's what you're going for. That's what you're heading towards. It is worth it to live for God. So adoption follows conversion in Scripture. It's different from justification. And it holds out immense privileges as well as effecting immense change. The believer relates to God as Father. So when Jesus taught, when you pray, say, Our Father who is in heaven, that figures. And that person who's now become a Christian, has been saved, has been redeemed, as Galatians spoke of it, from under the law, brought into a situation in a family, been adopted into the family of God, that person is drawn to God, cries out to God. Romans 8:15 and Galatians 4:6 both very clearly make that point. You're drawn to God and then led by the Spirit. What a privilege that is. You're in a world full of not knowing, uncertainty, doubting, not. To be led by the Spirit of God is to be led in the right way. And of course it means we're free of the old way under the law of having to perform and keep the rules and fear the big stick. Because you're set free into the liberty the children of God to be led by the Spirit into the ways of the family, the ways of the Father. And it conveys a status to those who received him, says John 1:12, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. And it brings immense security, 1 John 3:1-2. Look what manner of love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. And if we're made sons, what is the Christian's experience of adoption? Adoption brings with it, you know, the liberty and the leading and the, so many of the things we've looked at before already. Made a son or daughter of the living God. Brought into the family with a life to live, a status to hold, a security to enjoy. As a God to whom we cry out as Father. Who brings us into the inheritance of the children of God. Big stuff. God grant us grace to live as children of the King.